Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hacking for Dummies, 7th Edition, by Kevin Beaver, CISSP. Narrated by Tom Perkins. Publisher's note, in this audio edition you will hear references to figures, tables, URLs, and command sequences present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Limit of liability, disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and authors have used their best efforts in preparing this work, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this work, and specifically disclaim all warranties, including without limitation any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives, written sales materials, or promotional statements for this work. The fact that an organization, website, or product is referred to in this work as a citation and/or potential source of further information does not mean that the publisher and authors endorse the information or services the organization, website, or product may provide or recommendations it may make. This work is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering professional services. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a specialist where appropriate. Further, readers should be aware that websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Neither the publisher nor authors shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including, but not limited to, special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Introduction. Welcome to Hacking for Dummies, 7th Edition. This book outlines, in plain English, computer hacking tricks and techniques that you can use to assess the security of your information systems, find the vulnerabilities that matter, and fix the weaknesses before criminal hackers and malicious insiders take advantage of them. This hacking is the professional, above-board, and legal type of security testing, which I refer to as vulnerability and penetration testing, or ethical hacking, throughout the book. Computer and network security is a complex subject and an ever-moving target. You must stay on top of it to ensure that your information is protected from the bad guys and their exploits, including the growing challenges associated with ransomware. The techniques and tools outlined in this book can help. You could implement all the security technologies and other best practices possible, and your network environment might be secure as far as you know. But unless and until you understand how malicious attackers think, apply that knowledge, and use the right tools to assess your systems from their point of view, it's practically impossible to have a true sense of how secure your systems and information really are. Ethical hacking, or more simply, security assessments, which encompasses formal and methodical vulnerability and penetration testing, is necessary to find security flaws and to validate that your information systems are truly secure on an ongoing basis. Given the COVID-19 situation, ensuring security is especially critical today. With so many people working from home and outside the traditional enterprise network security controls, hacking and related breaches are off the charts. It's clear that businesses are having to adapt to new ways of working. IT and security professionals are also grappling with the associated emerging technologies, and that's only further complicating security. It's a tricky place to be and not an enviable position. Still, it represents an opportunity for learning and improving, so it's not all bad. This book will help you successfully navigate the craziness of the world as it relates to IT and security. I'll also help you implement a proper vulnerability and penetration testing program, perform the right security checks, and put the necessary countermeasures in place to keep external hackers and malicious users in check. About this book. Hacking for Dummies is a reference guide for hacking your systems to improve security and minimize business risks. The security testing techniques are based on written and unwritten rules of computer system vulnerability and penetration testing and information security best practices. This book covers everything from establishing your testing plan to assessing your systems to plugging the holes and managing an ongoing security testing program. Realistically, for most networks, operating systems, and applications, thousands of possible vulnerabilities exist. I don't cover them all, but I do cover the big ones on various platforms and systems that I believe contribute to most security problems in business today. I cover basic Pareto principle, 80-20 rule, stuff, with the goal of helping you find the 20% of the issues that create 80% of your security risks. Whether you need to assess security vulnerabilities on a small home office network, a medium-sized corporate network, or across a large enterprise, Hacking for Dummies provides the information you need. This book includes the following features: various technical and non-technical tests and their detailed methodologies, specific countermeasures to protect against hacking and breaches. Before you start testing your systems, familiarize yourself with the information in Part 1 so that you're prepared for the tasks at hand. The adage, "If you fail to plan, you plan to fail," rings true for the security assessment process. You must have a solid game plan in place if you're going to be successful. Foolish assumptions. Disclaimer: this book is intended solely for information technology, IT, and information security professionals to test the security of their or their clients' systems in an authorized fashion. If you choose to use the information in this book to hack or break into computer systems maliciously and without authorization, you're on your own. Neither I, the author, nor anyone else associated with this book shall be liable or responsible for any unethical or criminal choices that you might make and execute using the methodologies and tools that I describe. Okay, now that that's out of the way, let's get to the good stuff. This book is for you if you're a network administrator, IT or information security manager, security consultant, security auditor, compliance manager, or otherwise interested in finding out more about evaluating computer systems, software, and IT operations for security flaws, and of course, making long-term improvements. I also make a few assumptions about you, the aspiring information technology, IT, or security professional. You're familiar with basic computer, network, and information security concepts and terms. You have access to a computer and a network on which to use these techniques and tools. You have the go-ahead from your employer or your client to perform the hacking techniques described in this book. Icons used in this book. Throughout this book, you'll hear the following cues verbalized. Remember. This points out information that's worth committing to memory. Warning. This points out information that could have a negative effect on your vulnerability and penetration testing efforts, so please mind it. Tip. This refers to advice that can highlight or clarify an important point. Technical stuff. This points out technical information that's interesting but not vital to your understanding of the topic being discussed. Beyond the book. First off, be sure to check out the cheat sheet associated with this book. You can access the cheat sheet by visiting dummies.com and searching for Hacking for Dummies. The cheat sheet is a great way to get you pointed in the right direction or get you back on track with your security testing program if needed. Also, be sure to check out my website, www.principallogic.com, especially the resources page. Where to go from here? The more you know about how external hackers and rogue insiders work and how your systems should be tested, the better you're able to secure your computer and network systems. This book provides the foundation you need to develop and maintain a successful security assessment and vulnerability management program to minimize business risks. Depending on your computer and network configurations, you may be able to skip certain chapters. For example, if you aren't running Linux or wireless networks, you can skip those chapters. Just be careful. You may think you're not running certain systems, but they could very well be on your network somewhere waiting to be exploited. Keep in mind that the high-level concepts of security testing won't change as often as the specific vulnerabilities you protect against. Vulnerability and penetration testing will always remain both an art and a science in a field that's ever-changing. You must keep up with the latest hardware and software technologies, along with the various vulnerabilities that come about day after day and month after month. The good news is the vulnerabilities are often very predictable and, therefore, easy to discover and resolve. You won't find a single best way to hack your systems, so tweak this information to your heart's content, and happy hacking! 1. Building the foundation for security testing. In this part, discover the basics of vulnerability and penetration testing. Get a look inside a hacker's head to understand why and how they do what they do. Develop a security testing plan. Understand the methodology for finding the most and best vulnerabilities. Chapter 1. Introduction to Vulnerability and Penetration Testing. In this chapter, understanding hackers' and malicious users' objectives, examining how the security testing process came about, recognizing what endangers your computer systems, starting to use the process for security testing. This book is about testing your computers and networks for security vulnerabilities and plugging the holes you find before the bad guys get a chance to exploit them. Straightening out the terminology. Everyone has heard of hackers and malicious users. Many people have even suffered the consequences of their criminal actions. Who are these people, and why do you need to know about them? The next few sections give you the lowdown on these attackers. Remember, in this book, I use the following terminology. Hackers or external attackers try to compromise computers, sensitive information, and even entire networks for ill-gotten gains, usually from the outside, as unauthorized users. Hackers go for almost any system they think they can compromise. Some prefer prestigious, well-protected systems, but hacking into anyone's system increases an attacker's status in hacker circles. Malicious users, external or internal attackers, often called black hat hackers, try to compromise computers and sensitive information from the outside, such as customers or business partners, or the inside as authorized and trusted users. Malicious users go for systems that they believe they can compromise for ill-gotten gains or revenge, because they may have access or knowledge of a system that gives them a leg up. Malicious attackers are, generally speaking, both hackers and malicious users. For the sake of simplicity, I refer to both as hackers and specify hacker or malicious user only when I need to differentiate and drill down further into their unique tools, techniques, and ways of thinking. Ethical hackers or good guys, often referred to as white hat hackers or penetration testers, hack systems to discover vulnerabilities to protect against unauthorized access, abuse, and misuse. Information security researchers, consultants, and internal staff fall into this category. Warning: Hacker. Hacker has two meanings. Traditionally, hackers like to tinker with software or electronic systems. Hackers enjoy exploring and learning how computer systems operate. They love discovering new ways to work, both mechanically and electronically. Over the years, hacker has taken on a new meaning: someone who maliciously breaks into systems for personal gain. Technically, these criminals are crackers, criminal hackers. These crackers break into or crack systems with malicious intent. They seek fame, intellectual property, profit, or even revenge. They modify, delete, and steal critical information, and they spread ransomware and take entire networks offline, often bringing large corporations and government agencies to their knees. Don't get me started on how pop culture and the media have hijacked the word hack from life hacking to so-called election meddling. Marketers, politicians, and media strategists know that the average person doesn't understand the term hacking, so many of them use it however they desire to achieve their goals. Don't be distracted. The good guy, white hat hackers, don't like being lumped in the same category as the bad guy, black hat hackers. In case you're curious, the white hat and black hat come from old Western TV shows, in which the good guys wore white cowboy hats and the bad guys wore black cowboy hats. Gray hat hackers are a bit of both. Whatever the case, the word hacker often has a negative connotation. Many malicious hackers claim that they don't cause damage, but help others for the greater good of society. Yeah, whatever. Malicious hackers are electronic miscreants and deserve the consequences of their actions. Be careful not to confuse criminal hackers with security researchers. Researchers not only hack above board and develop the amazing tools that we get to use in our work, but they also, usually, take responsible steps to disclose their findings and publish their code. Unfortunately, there is a war going on against legitimate information security research, and the tools and techniques are often questioned by government agencies. Some people are even forced to remove these tools from their websites. Malicious user. A malicious user, meaning a rogue employee, contractor, intern, or other user who abuses their trusted privileges, is a common term in security circles and in headlines about information breaches. The issue isn't necessarily users hacking internal systems, but users who abuse the computer access privileges they've been given. Users ferret through critical database systems to glean sensitive information, email confidential client information to the competition or elsewhere to the cloud to save for later, or delete sensitive files from servers that they probably didn't need to have access to in the first place. Sometimes an innocent or ignorant insider, whose intent isn't malicious, still causes security problems by moving, deleting, or corrupting sensitive information. Even an innocent fat finger on the keyboard can have dire consequences in the business world. Think about all the ransomware infections affecting businesses around the world. All it takes is one click by a careless user for your entire network to be affected. Malicious users are often the worst enemies of IT and information security professionals because they know exactly where to go to get the goods and don't need to be computer savvy to compromise sensitive information. These users have the access they need and management trusts them, often without question. Recognizing how malicious attackers beget ethical hackers. You need protection from hacker shenanigans. Along the lines of what my father taught me about being smarter than the machine you are working on, you have to become as savvy as the guys who are trying to attack your systems. A true IT or security professional possesses the skills, mindset, and tools of a hacker, but is trustworthy. They perform hacks as security tests against systems based on how hackers think and work, and make tireless efforts to protect the organization's network and information assets. Remember, ethical hacking, otherwise known as vulnerability and penetration testing, involves the same tools, tricks, and techniques that criminal hackers use with one major difference. It's performed with the target's permission in a professional setting. The intent of this testing is to discover vulnerabilities from a malicious attacker's viewpoint to better secure systems. Vulnerability and penetration testing is part of an overall information risk management program that allows for ongoing security improvements. This security testing can also ensure that vendors' claims about the security of their products are legitimate. Security testing certifications. If you perform vulnerability and penetration tests and want to add another certification to your credentials, you may want to consider becoming a Certified Ethical Hacker, CEH, through a certification program by EC Council. See eccouncil.org for more information. Like Certified Information Systems Security Professional, CISSP, the CEH certification is a well-known, respected certification in the industry, accredited by the American National Standards Institute, ANSI 17024. Other options include the SANS Global Information Assurance Certification, GIAC, program, IACRB Certified Penetration Tester, CPT, and the Offensive Security Certified Professional, OSCP, program, a hands-on security testing certification. I love the approach of the certifications, as all too often, people who perform this type of work don't have the proper hands-on experience with the tools and techniques to do it well. See GIAC.org, IACertification.org, and offensive-security.com for more information. Vulnerability and penetration testing versus auditing. Remember, many people confuse security testing via vulnerability and penetration testing with security auditing, but big differences exist in the objectives. Security auditing involves comparing a company's security policies or compliance requirements with what's actually taking place. The intent of security auditing is to validate that security controls exist, typically by using a risk-based approach. Auditing often involves reviewing business processes, and in some cases, it isn't as technical. Some security audits, in fact, can be as basic as security checklists that simply serve to meet a specific compliance requirement. Not all audits are high level, but many of the ones I've seen, especially those involving compliance with the Payment Card Industry Data Security Standard, PCI-DSS, and the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, HIPAA, are quite simplistic. Often, these audits are performed by people who have no technical security experience, or worse, work outside IT altogether. Conversely, security assessments based on ethical hacking focus on vulnerabilities that can be exploited. This testing approach validates that security controls don't exist or are ineffectual. This formal vulnerability and penetration testing can be both highly technical and non-technical, and although it involves the use of formal methodology, it tends to be a bit less structured than formal auditing. Where auditing is required, such as for SSAE 18SOC reports and the ISO 27001 certification, in your organization, you might consider integrating the vulnerability and penetration testing techniques I outline in this book into your IT security audit program. You might actually be required to do so. Auditing and vulnerability and penetration testing complement one another really well. Policy considerations. If you choose to make vulnerability and penetration testing an important part of your business's information risk management program, you need to have a documented security testing policy. Such a policy outlines who's doing the testing, the general type of testing that's performed, and how often the testing takes place. Specific procedures for carrying out your security tests could outline the methodologies I cover in this book. You should also consider creating security standards documented along with your policy that outline the specific security testing tools used and the specific people performing the testing. You could establish standard testing dates, such as once per quarter for external systems and biannual tests for internal systems, whatever works for your business. Compliance and regulatory concerns. Your own internal policies may dictate how management views security testing, but you also need to consider the state, federal, and international laws and regulations that affect your business. In particular, the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, DMCA, sends chills down the spines of legitimate researchers. See eff.org/issues/DMCA for everything that the DMCA has to offer. Many federal laws and regulations in the United States, such as the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, HIPAA, and the Associated Health Information Technology for Economic and Clinical Health, HITECH Act, Graham-Leach-Bliley Act, GLBA, North American Electric Reliability Corporation, NERC, Critical Infrastructure Protection, CIP, requirements, and the Payment Card Industry Data Security Standard, PCI-DSS, require strong security controls and consistent security assessments. There's also the Cybersecurity Maturity Model Certification, CMMC. CMMC is a follow-on to NIST Special Publication 800-171, Protecting Controlled Unclassified Information in Non-Federal Systems and Organizations. This certification is intended to ensure that the U.S. Department of Defense's, DOD's, Defense Industrial Base, DIB, of suppliers, contractors, are adequately protecting the DOD's information assets. Related international laws, such as the Canadian Personal Information Protection and Electronic Documents Act, PIPEDA, the European Union's General Data Protection Regulation, GDPR, and Japan's Personal Information Protection Act, JPIPA, are no different. Incorporating your security tests into these compliance requirements is a great way to meet state and federal regulations and to beef up your overall information security and privacy program. Understanding the need to hack your own systems. To catch a thief, you must think like a thief. That adage is the basis of vulnerability and penetration testing. Knowing your enemy is critical. The law of averages works against security. With the increased number of hackers and their expanding knowledge, and the growing number of system vulnerabilities and other unknowns, all computer systems and applications are likely to be hacked or compromised somehow. Protecting your systems from the bad guys, not just addressing general security best practices, is critical. When you know hacker tricks, you find out how vulnerable your systems really are and can take the necessary steps to make them secure. Hacking preys on weak security practices and both disclosed and undisclosed vulnerabilities. More and more research, such as the annual Verizon Data Breach Investigations Report, shows that long-standing, known vulnerabilities are continually being targeted. Firewalls, advanced endpoint security, security incident and event management, SIEM, and other fancy and expensive security technologies often create a false feeling of safety. Attacking your own systems to discover vulnerabilities, especially the low-hanging fruit that gets so many people into trouble, helps you go beyond security products to make them even more secure. Vulnerability and penetration testing is a proven method for greatly hardening your systems from attack. If you don't identify weaknesses, it's only a matter of time before the vulnerabilities are exploited. As hackers expand their knowledge, so should you. You must think like them and work like them to protect your systems from them. As a security professional, you must know the activities that the bad guys carry out, as well as how to stop their efforts. Knowing what to look for and how to use that information helps you thwart their efforts. Tip: you don't have to protect your systems from everything. You can't. The only protection against everything is unplugging your computer systems and locking them away so no one can touch them. Not even you, and especially not your users. But doing so is not the best approach to security, and it's certainly not good for business. What's important is protecting your systems from known vulnerabilities and common attacks, the 20% of the issues that create 80% of the risks, which happen to be some of the most overlooked weaknesses in most organizations. Seriously, you wouldn't believe the basic flaws I see in my work. Anticipating all the possible vulnerabilities you'll have in your systems and business processes is impossible. You certainly can't plan for all types of attacks, especially the unknown ones. But the more combinations you try, and the more often you test whole systems instead of individual units, the better your chances are of discovering vulnerabilities that affect your information systems in their entirety. Don't take your security testing too far, though. Hardening your systems from unlikely or even less likely attacks makes little sense and will probably get in the way of doing business. Remember, your overall goals for security testing are to prioritize your systems so that you can focus your efforts on what matters, test your systems in a non-destructive fashion, enumerate vulnerabilities, and if necessary, prove to management that business risks exist, apply results to address the vulnerabilities and better secure your systems. Understanding the dangers your systems face. It's one thing to know generally that your systems are under fire from hackers around the world and malicious users around the office. It's another to understand specific potential attacks against your systems. This section discusses some well-known attacks, but is by no means a comprehensive listing. Many security vulnerabilities aren't critical by themselves, but exploiting several vulnerabilities at the same time can take its toll on a system or network environment. A default Windows operating system, OS, configuration, a weak SQL server administrator password, or a mission-critical workstation running on a wireless network may not be a major security concern by itself, but someone who exploits all three of these vulnerabilities simultaneously could enable unauthorized remote access and disclose sensitive information, among other things. Remember, complexity is the enemy of security. Vulnerabilities and attacks have grown enormously in recent years because of virtualization, cloud computing, and even social media. These three things alone add immeasurable complexity to your environment. On top of that, with the new ways of the world and so many people working from home, the complexities have grown exponentially. Non-technical attacks. Exploits that involve manipulating people, your users, and even you, are often the greatest vulnerability. Humans are trusting by nature, which can lead to social engineering exploits. Social engineering is exploiting the trusting nature of human beings to gain information, often via email phishing, for malicious purposes. With dramatic increases in the size of the remote workforce, social engineering has become an even greater threat, especially with more personal devices being used that are likely much less secure. Check out Chapter 6 for more information about social engineering and how to guard your systems and users against it. Other common effective attacks against information systems are physical. Hackers break into buildings, computer rooms, or other areas that contain critical information or property to steal computers, servers, and other valuable equipment. Physical attacks can also include dumpster diving, rummaging through trash cans and bins for intellectual property, passwords, network diagrams, and other information. Network infrastructure attacks. Attacks on network infrastructures can be easy to accomplish because many networks can be reached from anywhere in the world via the Internet. Examples of network infrastructure attacks include the following. Connecting to a network through an unsecured wireless access point attached behind a firewall. Exploiting weaknesses in network protocols, such as File Transfer Protocol, FTP, and Secure Sockets Layer, SSL. Flooding a network with too many requests, creating denial of service, DOS, for legitimate requests. Installing a network analyzer on a network segment and capturing packets that travel across it, revealing confidential information in clear text. Operating system attacks. Hacking an OS is a preferred method of the bad guys. OS attacks make up a large portion of attacks simply because every computer has an operating system. They are susceptible to many well-known exploits, including vulnerabilities that remain unpatched years later. Occasionally, some OSs that tend to be more secure out of the box, such as the old but still out there Novell NetWare, OpenBSD, and IBM Series I, are attacked, and vulnerabilities turn up. But hackers tend to prefer attacking Windows, Linux, and Mac OS because they're more widely used. Here are some examples of attacks on operating systems. Exploiting missing patches. Attacking built-in authentication systems. Breaking file system security. Installing ransomware to lock down the system to extort money or other assets. Cracking passwords and weak encryption implementations. Application and other specialized attacks. Applications take a lot of hits by hackers. Web applications and mobile apps, which are probably the most popular means of attack, are often beaten down. The following are examples of application attacks and related exploits that are often present on business networks. Websites and applications are everywhere, thanks to what's called shadow IT, in which people in various areas of the business run and manage their own technology. Website applications are in every corner of the internal network and out in the cloud. Unfortunately, many IT and security professionals are unaware of the presence of shadow IT and the risks it creates. Mobile apps face increasing attacks given their popularity in business settings. There are also rogue apps discovered on the app stores that can create challenges in your environment. Unsecured files containing sensitive information are scattered across workstation and server shares, as well as out into the cloud in places like Microsoft OneDrive and Google Drive. Database systems also contain numerous vulnerabilities that malicious users can exploit. Following the security assessment principles. Security professionals must carry out the same attacks against computer systems, physical controls, and people that malicious hackers do. I introduce those attacks in the preceding section. A security professional's intent, however, is to highlight any associated weaknesses. Parts 2 through 5 of this book cover how you might proceed with these attacks in detail, along with specific countermeasures you can implement against attacks on your business. To ensure that security testing is performed adequately and professionally, every security professional needs to follow a few basic tenets. The following sections introduce the important principles. Warning: if you don't heed these principles, bad things could happen. I've seen them ignored or forgotten by IT departments while planning and executing security tests. The results weren't positive, trust me. Working ethically. The word ethical in this context means working with high professional morals and values. Whether you're performing security tests against your own systems or for someone who has hired you, everything you do must be above board in support of the company's goals with no hidden agenda, just professionalism. Being ethical also means reporting all your findings, whether or not they may create political backlash. Don't laugh. On numerous occasions, I've witnessed people brushing off security vulnerability findings because they didn't want to rock the boat or to deal with difficult executives or vendors. Trustworthiness is the ultimate tenet. It's also the very best way to get and keep people on your side in support of your security program. Misusing information and power is forbidden. That's what the bad guys do. So let them be the ones who pay a fine or go to prison because of their poor choices. Respecting privacy. Treat the information you gather with respect. All information you obtain during your testing, from web application flaws to clear text email passwords to personally identifiable information, PII, and beyond, must be kept private. Nothing good can come of snooping into confidential corporate information or employees' or customers' private lives. Tip: involve others in your process. Employ a peer review or similar oversight system that can help build trust and support for your security assessment projects. Not crashing your systems. One of the biggest mistakes I've seen people make when trying to test their own systems is inadvertently crashing the systems they're trying to keep running. Crashing systems doesn't happen as often as it used to, given the resiliency of today's systems, but poor planning and timing can have negative consequences. Although you're not likely to do so, you can create DOS conditions on your systems when testing. Running too many tests too quickly can cause system lockups, data corruption, reboots, and similar problems, especially when you're testing older servers and web applications. I should know. I've done it. Don't assume that a network or specific host can handle the beating that network tools and vulnerability scanners can dish out. You can even accidentally create accounts or lock users out of the network without realizing the consequences. Proceed with caution and common sense. Either way, be it you or someone else, these weaknesses likely exist on your network, and it's better that you discover them first. Tip: most vulnerability scanners can control how many requests are sent to each system simultaneously. These settings are especially handy when you need to run the tests on production systems during regular business hours. Don't be afraid to throttle back your scans. Completing your testing will take longer, but throttling back may save you a lot of grief if an unstable system is present. Using the vulnerability and penetration testing process. As with practically any IT or security project, you need to plan security testing. It's been said that action without planning is the root of every failure. Strategic and tactical issues in vulnerability and penetration testing need to be determined and agreed on in advance. To ensure the success of your efforts, spend time planning for any amount of testing, from a simple OS password cracking test against a few servers to a penetration test of a complex web environment. Warning: if you choose to hire a reformed hacker to work with you during your testing or to obtain an independent perspective, be careful. I cover the pros and cons and the do's and don'ts associated with hiring security resources in Chapter 19. Formulating your plan. Getting approval for security testing is essential. Make sure that what you're doing is known and visible, at least to the decision makers. Obtaining sponsorship of the project is the first step. This is how your testing objectives are defined. Sponsorship should come from your manager, an executive, your client, or even yourself if you're the boss. You need someone to back you up and sign off on your plan. Otherwise, your testing may be called off unexpectedly if someone, including third parties such as cloud service and hosting providers, claims that you were never authorized to perform the test. Worse, you could be fired or charged with criminal activity. The authorization can be as simple as an internal memo or an email from your boss when you perform these tests on your own systems. If you're testing for a client, have a signed contract stating the client's support and authorization. Get written approval of this sponsorship before you ever start working to ensure that none of your time or effort is wasted. This documentation is your get-out-of-jail-free card if anyone, such as your Internet Service Provider, ISP, Cloud Service Provider, or a related vendor, questions what you're doing or if the authorities come calling. Don't laugh. It wouldn't be the first time it has happened. One slip can crash your systems, which isn't necessarily what anyone wants. You need a detailed plan, but you don't need volumes of testing procedures that make the plan overly complex. A well-defined scope includes the following information: specific systems to be tested. When selecting systems to test, start with the most critical systems and processes, or the ones that you suspect are the most vulnerable. You could test server OS passwords, test an internet-facing web application, or attempt social engineering via phishing before drilling down into all your systems. Another consideration is whether to test computer systems that are being used by employees who are working from home. Unless they are connected to the corporate environment over a VPN or are otherwise remotely accessible, you might not even be able to reach them. Furthermore, what are the ramifications of testing computers, especially personal systems, that are running on a home network? Are there medical devices, specific software, or Internet of Things systems that might be disrupted? Thinking all of this through with all the right people is imperative. Risks involved. Have a contingency plan for your security testing process in case something goes awry. Suppose that you're assessing your firewall or a web application and you take it down. This situation can cause system unavailability, which can reduce system performance or employee productivity. Worse, it might cause data integrity loss, loss of data itself, and even bad publicity. It'll most certainly tick off a person or two and make you look bad. All of these can create business risks. Handle social engineering and DOS attacks carefully. determine how they might affect the people and systems you test. Dates when the tests will be performed and overall timeline. Determining when the tests are to be performed is something you must think long and hard about. Decide whether to perform tests during normal business hours or late at night or early in the morning so that production systems aren't affected. Involve others to make sure that they approve of your timing. You may get pushback and suffer DOS-related consequences, but the best approach is an unlimited attack in which any type of test is possible at any time of day. The bad guys aren't breaking into your systems within a limited scope, so why should you? Some exceptions to this approach are performing all-out DOS attacks, social engineering, and physical security tests. Tip: whether you intend to be detected. One of your goals may be to perform the tests without being detected. You might perform your tests on remote systems or on a remote office and don't want the users to be aware of what you're doing. Otherwise, the users or IT staff may catch on to you and be on their best behavior instead of their normal behavior. Whether to leave security controls enabled. An important, yet often overlooked, issue is whether to leave enabled security controls such as firewalls, intrusion prevention systems, IPSs, and web application firewalls, WAFs, so that they block scans and exploit attempts. Leaving these controls enabled provides a real-world picture of where things stand. But I've found much more value in disabling these controls in the form of whitelisting your source IP addresses, so that you can pull back the curtains and find the greatest number of vulnerabilities. Many people want to leave their security controls enabled. After all, that approach can make them look better because many security checks will likely be blocked. To me, this defense-in-depth approach is great, but it can create a serious false sense of security and doesn't paint the entire picture of an organization's overall security posture. There's no right or wrong answer. Just make sure that everyone is on board with what is being tested and what the final outcomes and report represent. Knowledge of the systems before testing. You don't need extensive knowledge of the systems you're testing, just basic understanding, which protects both you and the tested systems. Understanding the systems you're testing shouldn't be difficult if you're testing your own in-house systems. If you're testing a client's systems, you may have to dig deeper. Only one or two clients have asked me for a fully blind assessment. Most IT managers and others who are responsible for security may be scared of blind assessments, which can take more time, cost more, and be less effective. Base the type of test you perform on the organization's or client's needs. Actions to take when a major vulnerability is discovered. Don't stop after you find one or two security holes. Keep going to see what else you can discover. I'm not saying that you should keep testing until the end of time or until you crash all your systems. Ain't nobody got time for that. Instead, simply pursue the path you're going down until you can't hack it any longer. Pun intended. If you haven't found any vulnerabilities, you haven't looked hard enough. Vulnerabilities are there. If you uncover something big, such as a weak password or SQL injection on an external system, you need to share that information with the key players, developers, database administrators, IT managers, and so on, as soon as possible to plug the hole before it's exploited. The specific deliverables. Deliverables may include vulnerability scanner reports and your own distilled report outlining important vulnerabilities to address, along with recommendations and countermeasures to implement. Selecting tools. As in any project, if you don't have the right tools for your security testing, you'll have difficulty accomplishing the task effectively. Having said that, just because you use the right tools doesn't mean that you'll discover all the right vulnerabilities. Experience counts. Tip: know the limitations of your tools. Many vulnerability scanners and testing tools generate false positives and negatives, incorrectly identifying vulnerabilities. Others skip vulnerabilities. In certain situations, such as testing web applications, you have to run multiple vulnerability scanners to find all the vulnerabilities. Many tools focus on specific tests, and no tool can test for everything. For the same reason that you wouldn't drive a nail with a screwdriver, don't use a port scanner to uncover specific network vulnerabilities or a wireless network analyzer to test a web application. You need a set of specific tools for the task. The more and better tools you have, the easier your security testing efforts will be. Make sure that you're using tools like these for your tasks. To crack passwords, you need cracking tools such as OffCrack and Proactive Password Auditor. For an in-depth analysis of a web application, a web vulnerability scanner, such as Acunetics Web Vulnerability Scanner or Probly, is more appropriate than a network analyzer, such as Wireshark or OmniPeak. The capabilities of many security and hacking tools are misunderstood. This misunderstanding has cast a negative light on otherwise excellent and legitimate tools. Even government agencies around the world are talking about making them illegal. Part of this misunderstanding is due to the complexity of some of these security testing tools, but it's largely based in ignorance and the desire for control. Whichever tools you use, familiarize yourself with them before you start using them. That way you're prepared to use the tools in the ways that they're intended to be used. Here are ways to do that. Read the README and/or online help files and FAQs, frequently asked questions. Study the user guides. Use the tools in a lab or test environment. Watch tutorial videos on YouTube, if you can bear the poor production of most of them. Consider formal classroom training from the security tool vendor or another third-party training provider if available. Look for these characteristics in tools for security testing: adequate documentation, detailed reports on discovered vulnerabilities, including how they might be exploited and fixed, general industry acceptance, availability of updates and responsiveness of technical support, high-level reports that can be presented to managers or non-technical types, especially important in today's audit and compliance-driven world. These features can save you a ton of time and effort when you're performing your tests and writing your final reports. Executing the plan. Good security testing takes persistence. Time and patience are important. Also, be careful when you're performing your tests. A criminal on your network or a seemingly benign employee looking over your shoulder may watch what's going on and use this information against you or your business. Making sure that no hackers are on your systems before you start isn't practical. Just be sure to keep everything as quiet and private as possible, especially when you're transmitting and storing test results. If possible, encrypt any emails and files that contain sensitive test information, or share them via a cloud-based file-sharing service. You're on a reconnaissance mission. Harness as much information as possible about your organization and systems, much as malicious hackers do. Start with a broad view and narrow your focus. Follow these steps. 1. Search the internet for your organization's name, its computer and network system names, and its IP addresses. Google is a great place to start. 2. Narrow your scope, targeting the specific systems you're testing. Whether you're assessing physical security structures or web applications, a casual assessment can turn up a lot of information about your systems. 3. Further narrow your focus by performing scans and other detailed tests to uncover vulnerabilities on your systems. 4. Perform the attacks and exploit any vulnerabilities you find, if that's what you choose to do. Check out Chapters 4 and 5 for information and tips on this process. Sample security testing tools. When selecting the right security tool for the task, ask around. Get advice from your colleagues and from other people via Google, LinkedIn, and YouTube. Hundreds, if not thousands, of tools are available for security tests. Following are some of my favorite commercial, freeware, and open-source security tools. Acunetics Web Vulnerability Scanner, Cain and Abel, Burp Suite, ComView for Wi-Fi, Elcomsoft System Recovery, Lucy, Manage Engine Firewall Analyzer, Metasploit, Nessus, NetScan Tools Pro, NetSparker, OmniPeak, Proactive Password Auditor, Probly, Qualys, SoftPerfect Network Scanner. I discuss these tools and many others in Parts 2 through 5 in connection with specific tests. Evaluating results. Assess your results to see what you've uncovered, assuming that the vulnerabilities haven't been made obvious before now. Knowledge counts. Your skill in evaluating the results and correlating the specific vulnerabilities discovered will get better with practice. You'll end up knowing your systems much better than anyone else does, which will make the evaluation process much simpler moving forward. Tip: submit a formal report to management or to your client outlining your results and any recommendations you need to share. Keep these parties in the loop to show that your efforts and their money are well spent. Chapter 17 describes the security assessment reporting process. Moving on. When you finish your security tests, you or your client will still need to implement your recommendations to make sure that the systems are secure. Otherwise, all the time, money, and effort spent on testing goes to waste. Sadly, I see this very scenario fairly often. Remember, new security vulnerabilities continually appear. Information systems change and are becoming more complex. New security vulnerabilities and exploits are being uncovered. Vulnerability scanners and related testing tools get better. Security tests provide a snapshot of the security posture of your systems. At any time, everything can change, especially after you upgrade software, add computer systems, or apply patches. This situation underscores the need to keep your tools updated before each use if possible. Plan to test regularly and consistently, such as monthly, quarterly, or biannually. Chapter 19 covers managing security changes as you move forward. Chapter 2: Cracking the Hacker Mindset. In this chapter, understanding the enemy, profiling hackers and malicious users, understanding why attackers do what they do, examining how attackers go about their business. Before you start assessing the security of your systems, it's good to know a few things about the people you're up against. Many security product vendors and security professionals claim that you should protect all of your systems from the bad guys, both internal and external. But what does this mean? How do you know how these people think and execute their attacks? Knowing what hackers and malicious users want helps you understand how they work. Understanding how they work helps you look at your information systems in a whole new way. In this chapter, I describe the challenges that you face from the people who actually do the misdeeds, as well as their motivations and methods. This understanding better prepares you for your security tests. What you're up against. Thanks to sensationalism in the media, public perception of hacker has transformed from a harmless tinkerer to a malicious criminal. Nevertheless, hackers often state that the public misunderstands them, which is mostly true. It's easy to prejudge or misjudge what you don't understand. Unfortunately, many hacker stereotypes are based on misunderstanding rather than fact, and that misunderstanding fuels a continued debate. Hackers can be classified by both their abilities and their underlying motivations. Some are skilled, and their motivations are benign. They're merely seeking more knowledge. Still, other hackers may have malicious intent and seek some form of personal, political, or economic gain. Unfortunately, the negative aspects of hacking usually overshadow the positive aspects and promote the negative stereotypes. Historically, hackers hacked for the pursuit of knowledge and the thrill of the challenge. Script kiddies, hacker wannabes with limited skills, aside, Traditional hackers are adventurous and innovative thinkers who are always devising new ways to exploit computer vulnerabilities. For more on script kiddies, see the section Who Breaks Into Computer Systems later in this chapter. Hackers see what others often overlook. They're very inquisitive and have good situational awareness. They wonder what would happen if a cable was unplugged, a switch was flipped, or lines of code were changed in a program. They do these things and then notice what happens. When they were growing up, hackers' rivals were monsters and villains on video game screens. Now hackers see their electronic foes as only that, electronic. Criminal hackers who perform malicious acts don't really think about the fact that human beings are behind the firewalls, web applications, and computer systems they're attacking. They ignore the fact that their actions often affect those human beings in negative ways, such as jeopardizing their job security and putting their personal safety at risk. Government-backed hacking? Well, that's a different story, as those hackers are making calculated decisions to do these things. On the flip side, the odds are good that you have at least an employee, contractor, intern, or consultant who intends to compromise sensitive information on your network for malicious purposes. These people don't hack in the way that people normally suppose. Instead, they root around in files on server shares, delve into databases they know they shouldn't be in, and sometimes steal, modify, and delete sensitive information to which they have access. This behavior can be very hard to detect, especially given the widespread belief among management that users can and should be trusted to do the right things. This activity is perpetuated if these users passed their criminal background and credit checks before they were hired. Past behavior is often the best predictor of future behavior. But just because someone has had a clean record and authorization to access sensitive systems doesn't mean that they won't do anything bad. Criminal behavior has to start somewhere. Remember, as negative as breaking into computer systems often can be, hackers and researchers play key roles in the advancement of technology. In a world without these people, the odds are good that the latest network and cloud controls, endpoint security, or vulnerability scanning and exploit tools would likely be different, if they existed at all. Such a world might not be bad, but technology does keep security professionals employed and the field moving forward. Unfortunately, the technical security solutions can't ward off all malicious attacks and unauthorized use because hackers and sometimes malicious users are usually a few steps ahead of the technology designed to protect against their wayward actions. Or the people in charge of these technologies are so distracted that they miss the obvious. However you view the stereotypical hacker or malicious user, one thing is certain. Somebody will always try to take down your computer systems and compromise information by poking and prodding where they shouldn't, through denial of service, DOS, attacks, or by creating and launching malware, especially ransomware. You must take the appropriate steps to protect your systems against this kind of intrusion. Thinking like the bad guys. Malicious attackers often think and work like thieves, kidnappers, and other organized criminals you hear about in the news every day. The smart ones devise ways to fly under the radar and exploit even the smallest weaknesses that lead them to their targets. Following are examples of how hackers and malicious users think and work. This list isn't intended to highlight specific exploits that I cover in this book or tests that I recommend that you carry out, but it demonstrates the context and approach of a malicious mindset. Evading an intrusion prevention system by changing the MAC or IP address every few minutes, or packets, to get farther into a network without being blocked. Exploiting a physical security weakness by being aware of offices that have already been cleaned by the cleaning crew and are unoccupied, and thus easy to access with little chance of getting caught. For example, such a weakness might be made obvious by the fact that the office blinds are opened and the curtains are pulled shut in the early morning. Bypassing web access controls by elevating their privileges via a vulnerable web page, the application's login mechanism, or a vulnerable password reset process. using unauthorized software that would otherwise be blocked at the firewall by changing the default TCP port on which it runs. Setting up a wireless evil twin near a local Wi-Fi hotspot to entice unsuspecting internet surfers onto a rogue network where their information can be captured and easily manipulated. Using an overly trusting colleague's user ID and password to gain access to sensitive information that they'd otherwise be highly unlikely to obtain and that could then be used for ill-gotten gains. Unplugging the power cord or Ethernet connection to a networked security camera that monitors access to the computer room or other sensitive areas, and subsequently gaining unmonitored system access. Performing SQL injection or password cracking against a website via a neighbor's unprotected wireless network to hide the malicious user's own identity. Malicious hackers operate in countless ways, and this list presents only a small number of the techniques hackers may use. IT and security professionals need to think and work this way to find security vulnerabilities that may not otherwise be uncovered. Who breaks into computer systems? Computer hackers have been around for decades. Since the Internet became widely used in the 1990s, the mainstream public has started to hear more about hacking. Certain hackers, such as John Draper, also known as Captain Crunch, and Kevin Mitnick, are well known. Many more unknown hackers are looking to make names for themselves, and they're the ones you have to look out for. In a world of black and white, describing the typical hacker is easy. The historical stereotype of a hacker is an antisocial, pimply teenage boy. But the world has many shades of gray, and many types of people do the hacking. Hackers are unique people, so a profile is hard to outline. The best broad description of hackers is that all hackers aren't equal. Each hacker has unique motives, methods, and skills. Hacker skill levels. Hacker skill levels fall into three general categories. Script kiddies. These hackers are computer novices who take advantage of the exploit tools, vulnerability scanners, and documentation available free on the Internet, but who don't have any real knowledge of what's going on behind the scenes. They know just enough to cause you headaches, but typically are very sloppy in their actions, leaving all sorts of digital fingerprints behind. Even though these guys are often the stereotypical hackers that you hear about in the news media, they need only minimal skills to carry out their attacks. Criminal hackers. Sometimes referred to as crackers, these hackers are skilled criminal experts who write some of the hacking tools, including the scripts and other programs that the script kiddies and security professionals use. These folks also write malware to carry out their exploits from the other side of the world. They can break into networks and computers and cover their tracks. They can even make it look as though someone else hacked their victim's systems. Sometimes people with ill intent may not be doing what's considered to be hacking. Nevertheless, they're abusing their privileges or somehow gaining unauthorized access. Advanced hackers are often members of collectives that prefer to remain nameless. These hackers are very secretive, sharing information with their subordinates, lower-ranked hackers in the collectives, only when they deem those subordinates to be worthy. Typically, for lower-ranked hackers to be considered worthy, they must possess unique information or take the gang-like approach by proving themselves through a high-profile hack. These hackers are some of your worst enemies in IT. Okay, maybe they're not as bad as untrained and careless users, but they're close. They do go hand in hand, after all. By understanding criminal hacker behavior, you're simply being proactive, finding problems before they become problems. Security researchers. These people are highly technical, publicly or somewhat publicly known security experts who not only monitor and track computer, network, and application vulnerabilities, but they also write tools and other code to exploit them. If these guys didn't exist, security professionals wouldn't have much in the way of open source and even certain commercial security testing tools. Tip: I follow many of these security researchers on a weekly basis via their personal or company blogs, Twitter feeds, and articles, and you should too. You can review my blog, principallogic.com, and the appendix included in the print and ebook formats of this book, which lists other sources from which you can benefit. Following the progress of these security researchers helps you stay up to date on vulnerabilities, as well as the latest, greatest security tools. I list tools and related sources from various security researchers in the appendix and throughout the book. Remember, hackers can be good, white hat, and bad, black hat, hackers. Gray hat hackers are a little bit of both. There are also blue hat hackers, outsiders who are hired to find security flaws in client systems. Blue hat hackers are more recently referred to as purple hat hackers. A study from the Black Hat Security Conference found that everyday IT professionals even engage in malicious and criminal activity against others. And people wonder why IT doesn't get the respect it deserves. Regardless of age and complexion, hackers possess curiosity, bravado, and often very sharp minds. Hacker motivations. Perhaps more important than a hacker's skill level is their motivation. The following groups of hackers have different motivations. Hacktivists. These hackers try to disseminate political or social messages through their work. A hacktivist wants to raise public awareness of an issue, but wants to remain anonymous. In many situations, these hackers try to take you down if you express a view that's contrary to theirs. Examples of hacktivism are the websites that were defaced by the Free Kevin messages that promoted freeing Kevin Mitnick, who was in prison for his famous hacking escapades.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.